Carson Turner, and I wave a stick. And this is the Pawleys Island Concert Band. It's not the whole band. Right? This is a very small part of the whole band, because the whole band is 67 people, and we barely fit in this room, and it will be even louder than it's about to be. So if you're one of those kinds of folks who are either very young and loud noises scare you, be ready, we're gonna make loud noises. Or if you're older and you have a loud noise amplifier in your ear, you might wanna turn it down. Because we will be loud. We'll get soft and loud. It won't be too terrible loud. We will start, it's not all space songs, but almost everything we do today will have something to do with space. It won't be, as the poster said, your favorite space songs, because I have no way of knowing what those are, so it has my favorite space songs. Some of them. As is tradition among concert bands and town bands, and we are your town band, the Pawleys Island Concert Band, all concerts and shows start with the exact same piece of music. Always. The National Anthem of the United States. So, for the young people who maybe never heard what to do, when you hear the National Anthem of the United States, we stand up straight. And if we have a hat off, we take it off. And we put it over our heart. But if we don't have a hat, we put our hand over our heart. And we either stand silent or sing the Star Spangled Banner. And I know everybody knows the words. No? Gotta learn the words before next time. So we can all sing together. This is the National Anthem. If you please rise if you're able. Your arm. By its name, because nobody does. Half the people in my band can't pronounce its name. It's Also Sprach Zarathustra. I know, right? It's a weird name for a song. It's German. But when you hear it, you're going to say, oh, space. Because that's what everybody uses it for. And it's pretty cool. And it gets loud. And Mr. Canty, who's running off, you can't leave. Oh, I'll talk some more. He's giving instructions. It's too late if we don't know it. Oh. If you picture music in your mind with pictures, this is about a sunrise from space. Well, when he wrote it, but that's what we use it for now. From looking out at the Earth from space, and the sun comes up over the Earth. Now, if you didn't know, this is the eve of tomorrow, which is the longest day of the year. And it's going to take a long time tomorrow for the sun to get from that side to that side. About 13 and a half hours. Yeah, It'll be a very long and hot day, and then a very short night. And that's called the solstice. That's tomorrow. You ready? Mr. Canty is going to conduct this one. Go for it. Stick's gonna go right through that head. Of the 330 people who have been astronauts since astronauts started in 1959, 219 of those astronauts have been military people. Almost all of the early ones were. In the very beginning, there were 7 astronauts. We're gonna play a special song for one of those later. But right now, we're going to play songs for each of the services of those astronauts, because that's what we do. We're a community band. There have been astronauts from every armed force. Everyone. And you wouldn't think, well, where'd they get an army astronaut? But they did. And even a Coast Guard. Not a merchant marine, though. However, the merchant marine did go and fish them out of the ocean. So every service has had something to do. And so these are the service songs. Now, tradition says if you are a veteran, when your song plays, you will rise. If you happen to be a Marine, I don't have to tell you tradition. I wouldn't be able to keep you seated. So if you know the songs and you hear your service song, I hope you know your song. You may rise during it. Otherwise, we're going to run all 7 of them. 7, you say? Yes, there are 7. All 7 of them through at once. Right, drummer, Gates.
Thank you.
the Merchant Marine. Nobody's ever heard that one, huh? They don't even know their song. I say that, but we've done a couple ceremonies in town where old Merchant Mariners have come up with tears that we played their song. Because you do never hear it. The order that you heard was the Army, then the Marine Corps. And people say, why are the Marines before the Navy if the Marines are part of the Navy? Because the Marines were founded first. And these are in order of founding. Then the Navy, then the Air Force, then the Coast Guard, then the Merchant Marine. There are two more services out there nobody ever thinks about. And they were involved in the space program too. One is the U.S. Public Health Service, where the Surgeon General works. And the other is the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, who had the sad task of recovering some debris from Challenger. That was NOAA. So we got to think about all these, so that they all exist. Pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you haven't noticed, some of you who are not little tiny people, my mindset as I prepared for this was little tiny people. So you're going to get talked to like you're little tiny people, sorry. Because that's what I prepared in my head. So, in space have been musical instruments. I know, right? Surprised? Lots of different kinds of musical instruments have been to space with the astronauts. There's been flute, guitar, a didgeridoo. I don't have a didgeridoo or I'd show you what one is. You'll just have to trust me. It's weird. But they have them in Australia. That's been to space. A saxophone went to space, but it never got to be played. And if you'd like to know that story, you'll just have to look it up because I'm not telling it today. But the first one, the very first instrument that went to space was in 1965 in the Gemini program. Y'all heard about Gemini, right?
Yeah.
Little tiny rockets went up in the air, people rode on them, and they hoped they didn't explode. Wally Schirra snuck on board his harmonica, just like this one. He snuck it on. Because you're not supposed to take extra things on rocket ships with you. They get very upset. And then he played it. And of course they had radio recordings going on and people at NASA found out that he had his harmonica because, well, they heard it. He tried to tell them it was Santa Claus, that Santa Claus had flown, but they didn't believe him. And when he got back, they took away his harmonica and wouldn't give it back. And he still hasn't got it back. It's in the Smithsonian Museum as the first instrument played in space. So what he played, we're not going to play today. Because when I tell you, you'll say, oh yeah, that's not appropriate. Jingle Bells. He played, that's why he told him it was Santa Claus. He played Jingle Bells in space. That was the first song played in space. And the first instrument was a Hohner Marine Band harmonica. But we are going to play something kind of close to Jingle Bells. But we're gonna hide it. We're gonna hide it in a march. And so you listen, you tell me of why this is Christmas music. In June, it's 95 degrees outside. So we can just envision ourselves in December complaining that it's not June. And so, 2 minutes, second innings, no repeats. 2 minutes, two base day. 1, 2, 2, and.
Thank you.
everybody was like, I didn't hear Christmas. Oh, we must have played it bad. But I saw some people were singing, so I think you got it. Another march, because marches are what we do best, because we're a concert band. So back in the late 50s, when all of this space stuff started, the United States was all concerned that those people from Russia were going to get up there in space before us. And we couldn't have that. Well, they did. They beat us up there. But it wasn't long after that that our first guy who floated around in space got up there, and that was John Glenn. Now, he was the oldest. I mean, you couldn't be over 40 years old or they wouldn't take you. And he was 39. And then they were like, no, can't go. But he was a test pilot. And he was the greatest test pilot. Like, if you don't know about test pilots, they get into airplanes that nobody has ever flown before, so we don't know if it's going to work or not. And then they fly it. Yeah, jets and everything. And it might crash. Lots of them did. And these guys, they didn't care. They just get up in there and they'd fly that airplane. And then we'd find out, yep, that one works, but that one don't. Don't make no more of those. And that's how he got in the space program. So he got to be the first guy to ride, first human guy of Americans that got to ride in a spaceship and go to space. And that was pretty cool. So we're going to play a march for Colonel Glenn, who later, after he got out of the Navy, then the Marine Corps, then the Air Force, then the Marine Corps, because he just couldn't make up his mind, became a U.S. Senator and stayed a senator for a very long time. So that is an American right there, right? Fine American. And this is Semper Fidelis, which is, Oh, that's right. He was the, not only, yeah, well, he was the oldest the first time, too, at that time. But he also has been twice when he was, I don't know how old, 50-something. Really? How old? Anybody know? 80s? Yeah, because it was on a space shuttle. Yeah, the oldest guy. And nobody's beat that one yet. Y'all want to sign up? Me neither. So, yeah, he as I said, that, he did other things besides be a spaceman. He was in World War II. He was a fighter pilot. He was in Korea. He was a fighter pilot. He was in Vietnam. He was a fighter pilot. This guy, I mean, you want to talk about hardcore. And I don't think he cared. I don't think he believed he could die. He must have just thought, nope, not going to happen to me. Because he just kept on, right, driving on. So this is Semper Fidelis, the Marines' official field march. Second innings, no repeats. Straight from the top at march tempo, two measures. One, two, one, and go. Thank you. remember my order.
What's that so, thing there for?
It's the yellow.
Yes, it's plastic.
On the floor?
Yeah.
That holds his instrument when he's not playing it. So he don't drop it. So y'all remember, some of you don't remember because you weren't here yet. Some of y'all's moms and daddies wasn't here yet. Y'all remember 1969 when Mr. Armstrong and his crew of Apollo 11 went to walk on the moon?
Yeah.
And my daddy made me come in the house and watch one of the three channels on the television. Because somebody was in black and white. I think we had color though. And it was baseball playing day and I had to miss baseball practice. I was so annoyed. Because I was still pretty little. Not all that little. And we watched a man walk on the moon for the first time. And the hottest toy for us boys and many of the girls was rockets. We all had to have rockets. We wanted to build rockets. We all wanted to be astronauts and go to space. And so I built me a rocket model, not a real rocket. But you're not allowed to build yourself a real rocket. It would be bad. But I built this rocket model, a Saturn rocket, that was as tall as me. And I put a lot of work into my rocket. And this rocket was supposed to be able to fly with stages. And the little rocket motors pop out, right? You seen those? We used to all do that because it was a big deal to become engineers or scientists or mathematicians so that we could all go to space and see the final frontier where no man has gone before. Like, that's a different thing. So I built this rocket. And the day comes, and I've piled up my little rocket motors in their order, and I've got them wired up to my little, there's a little box, and it's got wires, and you flip the switch, and the motors are really little tiny firecrackers. But they make the rocket fly. Yeah. And so, it's time. Remember the countdown? Let's do the countdown. Right? 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, everybody, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I blew my rocket to smithereens. It just did not go anywhere. It blew into bits. And this is why I'm not an astrophysicist and why I'm a musician. I did play with rockets and such later. But I just thought I'd share that story. We wanted to go to, and we still do, we haven't been there yet, Mars. Everybody was about Martians. Remember my favorite Martian? Okay, they don't really look like that. Everybody knows Martians are green. Okay, maybe there's not even Martians. Right. And they try to blow things up too. Right. So this piece is called Mars. It's about Mars. It's by Gustav Holst. It's classical music. Now, we played marches earlier, and everybody knows that all marches that were ever written were written by John Philip Sousa. And all classical music that was ever written was written by Mozart. Okay, no. This is by Gustav Holst, and it was written for a wind ensemble and not an orchestra. In a minute, I'm going to explain all about bands and orchestras and these instruments. In fact, after we finish this, this one gets loud, this one makes sudden noises, so if those kind of things bother you, just be ready, because we're going to do it. Mars. Mars is angry, by the way. I never quite understood why he was so angry, but you're going to feel Mars be angry. Also, if you want to tap your feet, instead of going 1, 2, 1, 2, you're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, it's weird. You can't dance to this. Right on 1. know that one, though. I don't think they know it. I know. Okay. So, while I get my breath, I'm going to tell you about the things that they have. They all have things. I showed you my harmonica. It's in my pocket somewhere. Harmonicas are cool because they fit in your pocket. That's how he was able to sneak it on. Pretty easy, right? But they don't have harmonicas in bands. How sad, right? You wouldn't be able to hear it over this band. The difference between a band and an orchestra is stringed instruments like violins and violas and cellos and basses. You'll notice we have none. We have all things that you either blow in or you beat on it. But no things that you drag a bow over it. And that makes us a band. Now, bands are louder than orchestras, as you might have noticed. And the ideal use of a band is to play outside. Unless you live on the coast of South Carolina. Then you don't want to play outside because it's hot. Real hot. So militaries, armies, have bands, not orchestras. And the reason they have that is because we're loud. And you can hear us. And we can play marches and people can follow along and march in tempo. So in our band, we have a piccolo flute player. She has a piccolo and two flutes. And piccolos are itty bitty tiny flutes. She also has an in-between flute, because we're special and we get to have that. All bands don't have the in-between flute. So play us a tweedle-ee. They go tweedle-ee-dle-ee mostly. Pretty cool, right? Yeah.
I'm a clarinet when I play this. I'm an E-flat clarinet.
But that's a flute. Yeah. And if you would like to play a flute, that's what that is. Next to the flutes are clarinets. That's a clarinet. Play some clarinet. Oh, he's going to play his jazz clarinet, of course. Clarinets are used in jazz bands. Benny Goodman played a clarinet. Artie Shaw played a clarinet. Lots of people play jazz with clarinets, but we use them as soprano voices, just like your church choir uses their sopranos. Mostly melody. The other mostly melody instrument we have are trumpets. Just about everybody knows a trumpet, right? You know what a trumpet does. So in the military bands, sometimes trumpets play bugle calls, like to give instructions to people because it's loud. And you can hear it. Oh, play some bugle call. And that bugle call means the horses are about to. That's first call. And first call means you better pay attention because another call is coming in just a minute. And if you don't do whatever that is that comes in a minute, you'll either miss it or be in a lot of trouble. Some of them you don't want to miss. Because there's one called mess call, and that means it's time to eat. And if you miss that, you just don't get to eat. Yeah, be bad. The other thing trumpets do is play songs, melodies, lyrical things. Play us a melody thing. Any kind. Trumpets are cool. Right? You like trumpets? To the left of the trumpets, hold up a French horn. It's not really French, but we call it a French horn because that's what they named it. And they're different than all the other instruments that have buttons that go up and down because the French horn players play left-handed. Trumpets and euphoniums and everybody else, that's right-handed. But French horns play with their left hand and they shove their right hand inside it. Because they're too loud and we don't want to hear, no, that's not why. To mute the sound down so that it's not too brash. So give us a horn thing.
There's a story about Siegfried. He's a hero and he's trying to wake up a dragon. He's looking for the dragon. He doesn't know which mountain the dragon's sleeping in, so he has a little call.
some Bugs Bunny, What's Opera Doc? That's in it. In fact, almost all of us in this room would probably have to admit, all of the classical music I ever learned, I learned from Bugs Bunny. Maybe some from Tom and Jerry. Right? On the other side, two alto saxes. An alto sax is a saxophone. It's a woodwind instrument. Even though it's made out of brass, it's not a brass family instrument. It's a woodwind like a clarinet. And they're used in jazz, and they often play melodies. Give us a thing, Bob. Instrument, not player. The clown instrument in a band is the bassoon. There, half of you have been sitting here wondering all day anyway, what is that funny looking thing? That's a bassoon. Right, bedpost that makes honking noises. So give us a honky thing. Pretty cool. Nice bassoon playing. The other clown in the band, instrument, not the player, is the tuba. That's our tuba back there in the corner. We named her Cece. We just bought her not too long ago. At one of our concerts, our band president stood up and said, hey, if anybody's got a few thousand dollars they don't need, we need a tuba. And somebody came and gave us a check. And so we got a tuba, and that's Cece the tuba. Play some Cece tuba for us. Yeah. Everybody knows tuba, right? In front of the tubas are a member of the tuba family, the euphonium. Sometimes called a baritone, but those aren't, those are euphoniums. And sometimes called a tenor horn. But what it really is a tiny tuba. And it plays the lyric opera man parts. Like Luciano Pavarotti kind of stuff. Or if you come hear us on the 4th of July, Danny Boy. Give me a euphonium something. Slide on it. And right behind the trombones is Bruce. Bruce drives this bus. He's our drummer. And he sets the speed and how loud. He plays really loud. Everybody else will play really loud. Even if I say, don't play loud, they'll do what he does. That's what they do. Give us some drumming. Stick's broken. I can tap it, but that's just when people are misbehaving. If I tap my stick, that means y'all have been making too much noise. All the things I do with my stick communicate something to the band. Hopefully, I communicate something favorable to the band, and maybe if I don't, hopefully they'll just ignore me. But the conductor's job is to take every one of those instruments and bring them together to play one music together and to interpret how we're going to play it. So we just did Mars, for example, a little slower than we normally do. And they knew that because I said, one, two, three, four. 5, instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, which we would normally do. And the reason I did that is because I happened to hear that a couple people weren't quite ready to go fast. Fine. That's my job as the conductor. Now, some people think, oh, well, yeah, conductors are in charge. Not. I just flap my arms. In fact, if I flap my arms, like right now, nothing happened. They're in charge. It's not quite what I had in mind. But we have a board of directors, and we have administrative people who do lots and lots of things with the band. Dane, for example, makes videos. And you think, how much trouble could it be to make a video? You put up the camera, you go, yeah, now he gets to go home after we're all going to dinner, and he's gonna download that video into the computer and like, try to make things sound right, get it back up on the internet so you can watch it later tonight on YouTube, or maybe tomorrow. And we have a librarian who counts all of our music. We have a lot of music, a whole room full of it. We have a treasurer who counts our money. We don't have enough money. Never enough money. And a secretary who counts our people and writes thank you letters to people who give them. And other board members, who all board members are here? Dwayne's a board member, and me, and that's it. And we have a band president. And all of these things go into making this organization be able to sit here and do this. And we do it for fun. None of us get paid. Nobody in the band gets any money for this. We actually spend an awful lot of money. And when we're done with the last thing we're going to play, if you little people want to come up and take a look at the instruments close up, just don't touch. Because you've got things here. You've got things here that cost upward of $9,000, $10,000. Little things cost $9,000, $10,000. Big things cost more. And we buy those. The band doesn't own most of these. We own a few things, but not much. So if you happen to have an instrument that you used to play, assuming you don't want to come play it on Tuesday nights at 7, because we'd love to have you, especially if it's a clarinet. If you have an instrument under the bed, in the closet, what have you, you don't want it, we have a use for it all the time, okay? And you'd like to donate it, we'd like to have it. And we're a 501c3, so all you little people who have high incomes and need a tax write-off, well, next time you do, you know, you get that IRA distribution and you've got, oh wait, that's not the problem you got to worry about yet. But the rest of you who get IRA distributions and you need something to do with them, we'd like to have that too. If you'd like to just write, sign off on the back of the check and hand it over. But we are publicly funded, and we're publicly funded by this community. And I'm not begging for money. I'm not going to take a collection today. I'm just sharing that fact. This community supports us very, very well. As community bands in the United States goes, we are huge, and we're very well funded. And we thank you for that, because you make that possible. But that's not to say that if you want to give me some money, I will say no. But if you do want to give us money, give us some land. He has access to bank account. So now, next thing we're going to play has absolutely nothing to do with space. Nothing. I can't think of a way to make this about space. Other things I can make about space, but this one, we're playing it because it's fun. Right? And funny. And the trombones we're messing around and playing it. This is called Lassus Trombone. So Lassus Trombone was written by a guy named Henry Fillmore, who isn't John Philip Sousa, but he wrote lots and lots of marches. I think he wrote the one, no, Bagley. And it's a humorous novelty march. And they played it at circuses a lot back in the circus days. Now the circuses are about gone, and all the circus bands are gone. But it's funny, so if you want to laugh, you may go right ahead. Ready? Two measures of two, as written, all of the endings, all of the beats. Two measures of two. One, two, two. Thank you. see how I did. I did really good. I did. So, when Mr. Armstrong stepped off of that spaceship onto the moon, one of the things he did while he was up there is he took a flag and he stuck it, yes, an American flag, and stuck that flag into the moon. And it's still there. And if you have a good enough telescope, they tell me, you might be able to find it if everything's turned just right. Okay? Which is cool. This then will end our show for the day. Is about the flag. And it's called National Emblem. And you can clap along if you want. The faster you clap, the faster I'll make them go. It's like band torture. It's not Stars and Stripes Forever, though, because we don't have enough band for that one today. But this will be it. National Emblem. As written. Two measures of two. As written, a little bit quicker. A one, two, two. And...